Hi guys, and welcome to yet another video. And if I screw this one up, it stays screwed. Cheers. I'm asked a number of questions, one of which is, what advice would I give to someone who's wanting to get equipment to play vinyl records? As today, an article hit the news that vinyl has hit a 25-year sales record, mostly off the back of David Bowie, believe it or not. People rediscovering his back catalogue now that he's gone. What a time to discover the artist. Sales have not been this good apart from 25 years ago, is the long story short. Exactly what's going on, exactly what's driving this, I couldn't pretend to tell you. And when it comes to this specific question, I'm probably not the best person to answer it either. If you'd asked me 30 years ago, I might have had a clue when I was keeping up to date on what was going on and all the rest of it. These days, although the principles are the same, the technology has just improved vastly over the last 30 years. And I can only... the best I can do is just give some generic advice and let you do your own research, because these days there are a whole raft of different options that you can choose from depending on what you want to do and where you want to go. As you can see, I started this video already and failed it. Purely because the turntable is such a complicated piece of equipment when it comes to the choices that you've got to make, the balances that you've got to think of. One of them, for example, is direct versus belt drive. Direct is a very strong physical linkage between the motor and the platter. You get a good speed control. The downside is that any vibration that's coming off the motor gets transmitted down the linkage to the platter. With a belt system, because basically you've got a rubber belt, the physical speed drive is not as accurate, but it absorbs some of the vibration that's coming off the motor. It's not a question of is one better than the other, it's more a question of preference. In my case, my preference was sort of limited by the amount of money I had to spend. And I've got to be honest, if it hadn't been for somebody giving me a kick up the arse in the comments, I wouldn't have even done that. I would have stuck with the cheap USB turntable that I bought. And, yep. The next is what cartridge is going to come on it. And you have moving magnet or moving coil. Typically, I've only wound up with moving magnets, typically because of the price range that I'm playing in, which is very low. You have things like the arm. On this particular deck that I've got, it's carbon fiber. In the day, it was one of the expensive options. These days, it's the price is coming down. And there's a whole load of other things that you've got to consider. I ended up with the Project Debut Carbon. Project being the name of the company, and the Debut Carbon is the name of that particular deck. It's not a new deck, but looking at the reviews when I did my research, it's still a consistent performer. You can get it in a number of configurations. Mine came with an Autophon 2M cartridge, red. Not the best. Decidedly an entry level for that particular range, but the bonus was it came pre-fitted, pre-configured, which is a big thing. I mean, if you've ever tried to fit your own cartridge, I mean, the deck came with an alignment tool, but if you've ever tried to align your own cartridge, it can drive you nuts. So the fact that this particular one came with that cartridge pre-fitted, all the rest of that jazz, that was good for me. A new needle for this particular cartridge is like £60. So it wasn't to be sniffed at. You know, when you take that off the cost of the deck and yada yada. That's where my research ended up. So, you got to do a bit of digging around. Find whatever deck is going to suit your pocket. And the person in the comments was right. You know, £300 is probably the minimum you're going to spend for an entry-level deck that's going to be any use, any good. And, you know, I can hear the rumble and other things coming off that. You know, it's a balance, but, you know, £300 was the best that my pocket was going to go to on that one. The next thing you've got is your preamp. The preamp will typically output a line signal. The cartridge will not be putting out very much of a strong signal, so you need a preamp involved in order to get it out to a line level signal. You've heard me talk about this before in when I've been was talking about the headphone amplifiers. Then three, you've got your main amplifier. Well, I'll just call it amplifier. Your general purpose amplifier, which will then drive a number of things, and then your choice is a number of things off there. Either phones or speakers. Now, for most amplifiers of the day, typically integrated amplifiers, you know, in the hi-fi days 30 odd years ago, and you can still, the majority of chunky everyday amplifiers in hi-fi now have a range of inputs, but one of those inputs will be for a preamp for a phono, for vinyl, for a cartridge. So, you know, like the Yamaha I've got down there that you've seen in previous videos. One of the inputs was a preamp for a magnetic, for a moving magnet. So the one amplifier did both these jobs. It had a number of line inputs for CD, tuner, tape deck, yada yada, but one of them was a specific phono input for a preamp for the cartridge. There was a third line, which is for the earthing connection, and that's pretty much also needed. Without that earthing connection, you get a degree of hum. The kind of cables that came with the Debut Carbon was were pretty nice. How much I'd pay for an amplifier depends, and it also depends on a wide variety of things. If you're intending to drive speakers, then your typical amplifier will allow you to drive both speakers and phones. But if you're not going to run speakers, typically like most of my listening is done on headphones, so you don't need a heavy-duty amplifier. A headphone amplifier will do. So this could be the Yamaha, for example. Yamaha, which does both these jobs. Or what I've done is I've got a separate preamp, and also I can plug into different amplifiers as I wish. Now, the preamp that I have is another one by Project. I'll look it up. I've got it on the screen down here. It's the Project Phono Box E, and it Phono Box E, and that cost me about £40. That puts out the line signal. So that's my preamp. So we're already knocking on about 360 quid there. What I could do with the line output was various things. As you know, I feed it into the computer, which is what I do for the ripping. But as you've also seen, I've got different headphone amplifiers just to drive the phones. And I've got my nice little Valve headphone amplifier there. It's nothing special. I think that costs about £90. Because I do like the sound of vinyl when it's put through Valve amplifiers. That's just a personal taste thing. You're not going to... It's one of those things that's... It's a flavour thing. You know, even different styles of music and different types of music. You know, I do prefer the Valve for vocals. If I'm listening to a cappella, I'll sling it through the Valve every time. Other stuff, I'll just fire up the, you know, there's the small amplifier that's just the Teac, a whatever the heck it is. You see, that's the level of my interest now. Now that I've done my research and God, I can't even remember what the heck I was researching about a few months ago. But I'll just twist that on and listen to that. And that's the thing, it's a case of mix and match, and the setup can grow as you wish. It's not so easy to get another, because of the bulk of your money goes on the turntable, it's probably best to invest in that first and then upgrade your preamp or your main amp and your phones or speakers at a later date. So you don't have to rush out and do all this at once. And it is just completely dependent on how you want to build your setup. How you want to make it, how you want to put it together, how you want to listen to the music. And you can mess around with this stuff. You know, different preamps, different amps, different phones, different speakers. Because they've all got their own individual characteristics. And there's no right way or wrong way. The important thing is, I think, is to take the time to learn about these options and pick something that's right for you. Something that you're happy to listen to and that you'll enjoy listening to. Because it's pointless spending shed loads of money for something that you're not going to enjoy listening to. I didn't relish. When I got that kick in the comment section, I didn't relish what it would mean. Because it would mean... I knew exactly what it meant. It meant doing all the research all over again. Am I glad I did it? Actually, I think I am. You know, it's... It has kicked off the interest in the vinyl again, and now that I've got the main work done, ripping and cleaning and resampling, now I can just settle down and enjoy stuff. I still haven't worked out the sort of everyday clean, that's still got to be sorted out. But the modern vinyl is actually performing quite well. I'm certainly enjoying things. It's not that often that I get the chance to just kick back for an hour or two with a glass or two of wine and just listen to the vinyl. You know, it's not that often, but it's enjoyable when I do it. Not only for the sound, but also for the ritual. I know that sounds odd, but there you go. So, the long story short is, of these four sections, it's up to you as to where you want to go, and those two can be joined in the one amplifier if you want. I think the easiest thing is that it can be taken in steps. You haven't got to go and get it all at once, and you can just do your research and take your time. The key thing is that you're not going to be able to use the turntable without some sort of a preamp. Most of them are moving magnet. If you do wind up with moving coil for some reason, if you've bought a second-hand deck or something, and you've got a moving coil, be aware that the preamp is going to have to match what you're putting out. The same preamp may not work for both moving magnet and moving coil. I believe that some of the modern ones can actually sense and jump automatically. I know the Project Phonobox E, there was another version prior to that. And it had a load of dip switches at the bottom, which you had to set depending on the cartridge and depending on a number of things. You had to actually look up. There was a table where you put your cartridge. You looked up your cartridge and you set the dip switches accordingly. The one that actually came didn't have all that. It seems to be doing it automatically. I don't know. It just seems to be magic. Haven't got a clue. But I was prepared for a bit of a fight. The most important thing that I will say is that when you get your turntable, if you are not used to fitting a cartridge, save yourself the bother and put the extra money behind a cartridge that's already been fitted for you. You'd have to buy a cartridge anyway, so you might as well just get one that's and let somebody else do the work for you, because it will be worth the money, I tell you. And then just I mean, if you get a cartridge that's going to suit you from the get-go, then there's not really that much point in upgrading it until you actually get to a point where you want to upgrade it. I mean, I'm perfectly happy with that sort of entry-level cartridge now. Very happy with it. When later on I listen to more, I don't know. Maybe I'll feel different. But you are talking a fair chunk of cash for some of the needles, and like everyone, I've got to make a trade-off. So I hope that's pretty much helped. I think for an entry level, about £150 in this area to match that kind of turntable isn't overkill. It would probably be a reasonable amount. You may want to go up to 200, yada yada. Read some reviews, do some research, and remember that you've got options. You can just go for a headphone amp like I have and not even bother about driving speakers at all. You know, it's all down to you. And just sit down, think about your preferences, and work it out. You know, think of it as a journey. You haven't got to go out there and do all this kaboom and there. Do it in stages. Take your time. Enjoy the experience of the equipment and the research as much as listening to the vinyl itself. So, there you go. That's me ranting and raving for another 20 minutes. Nearly enough. I can't really read it from here. I've got LEDs blinding me. And, in case a few people do comment, I know that the LEDs are on sort of a par, and I've got some brackets to lift them up and out in the future, but they're going to take some time to come here. So I'm sorry, you're going to have to make do with the reflection in my glasses for a while. So, catch you guys on the next video. Bye for now.